Are you ready to jump into how cost can affect your referrals? We're getting started on the six essence components of referral mastery today. Cost is going to be our first one. We're going to spend all week talking about cost and how it can be referral blockage and how you can use it to your advantage. So that's coming up today on Coffee with Dr. Scott. Thank you for joining me. Let's get right into today's question of the day, because I'm very excited about it. Question of the day, what was the greatest thing you had to eat over the weekend? If you remember from last week, I was fasting. I was drinking water all week, and now I'm back to my coffee. Although, funny thing is, I'm actually fasting today as well. I am drinking coffee, back to coffee, which is great. You know, I think I told everybody last week, I know a lot of you are coffee drinkers, but I've actually got a couple of messages from people who are like, you shouldn't be drinking coffee at all. And I get that. But I like coffee. And last week I didn't drink coffee at all. In fact, a couple comments said there's no such thing as too much coffee. I tend to agree, but I really feel like I drank coffee over the weekend and I was drinking a lot less. So I'm very happy with the fast and the way it did that. Still enjoy my coffee, probably even enjoy it more now. But I want to know what the greatest thing you had to eat over the weekend, because I did finally get to eat over the weekend. I did 5.5 days of a water fast. Saturday morning, broke that fast with a bacon, spinach, and Gouda omelet that was just out of this world. Had a bunch of Easter celebrations over the weekend, so we ate really, really well. Some pulled pork. I forget what we ate that night. My daughter fasted with me, so she controlled a lot. We had some ribeyes. I forget what we had the night before, Saturday night. I know it was well planned, but what was it? Anyways, had some great food, really enjoyed it, and now I'm fasting every Monday now. That's my new thing since I enjoyed the fast so much. I've decided that from Sunday night till Tuesday morning, I'm just not eating except for a little coffee in the morning to get me through the day. So, that's my new thing. Let's see what people had to eat this weekend. Toast. Everybody in the house had a GI Bug all weekend. Great story, Tyler, and great for me to enjoy my food even more. Coconut cream pie from scratch. Ooh, you know what? I told you we were doing this fast for my daughter, for her skin. So I am having her try keto for 2 weeks just to see how it affects it. I do not want my daughter eating keto for a lifestyle. She certainly doesn't need to lose any weight, and she needs a little bit of carbs for her energy. But it's just something we're trying for 2 weeks. So she's got a little bit of a sugar tooth. So we got some keto lava cakes that the first night were a little chalky, like keto desserts typically are. So we went on with these keto lava cakes and we kept adapting them for 3 consecutive nights and finally came up to a really, really good one last night. So keto lava cakes was another thing that we had that was really, really good last night. So anyways, put your what your best foods you had to eat over the weekend down in the comments down below. I see Ken says here, Lachon, roasted pork. Oh, I like roasted pork as well. Very good. So what else we got going on here? I am out on tour. Oh, no, let's talk about the 30-day challenge. So what we've decided, we're going to do, if you remember last week, we were talking about several 30-day challenges we could do. And let's not call it a 30-day challenge. Let's just call it a challenge. Because we're going to do several of them. I felt like the comments I was getting back the most were morning routine challenges. So we're going to go back to the morning routine for 2 weeks. So not a 30-day challenge. We're just going to refresh that. And it might be something that just kind of comes up every month for a week or two. So for the next 2 weeks, we're really going to get back on that morning routine challenge. Here we are coming back from Easter. Great time to, about renewal. So tomorrow morning, we're going to start talking about morning routines again. So tomorrow morning, get back on your morning routine. Come back telling me how good you can do on morning routines. And for the next 2 weeks, we're going to dig into some of the things that maybe you're having trouble with. So that would be the comment of the day number two. Put your comment in down below of what's lacking in your morning routine. What do you need help with? And then we'll address that over the next 2 weeks. So if you did great in January and now you're slacking, where are you slacking? If you never picked something up, never quite got there, let me know what that is and we'll work on that. So give me some ideas today of what we should work on over the next 2 weeks and we're going to do the morning routine challenge. Now on Fridays, we are going to get back to our Finance Friday ideas, So we're going to talk a little bit about that living like a pauper thing, but we're not going to dig into it as a challenge. That's what we decided. Nobody seems like they want to have fun with it, but I want to work on it. So on Fridays, we might start working on some stuff just to kind of get us conscious of our spending. So Finance Fridays, we're still going to work on that, and we're going to start that this Friday. So 2 weeks of morning routine. Friday, every Friday, we're going to work on spending. And we're also going to work on income. Finance Friday means making money, too. So we'll work on some fun stuff there. And then we are going to bring up the one thing challenge starting 3 weeks. Well, really, 2 weeks from today. 2 weeks today, we're going to talk about the one thing challenge. So I want you all to spend the next 2 weeks thinking about what your one thing is. What the one thing you should be focused on that is really going to change your life. One habit. And then we're going to spend probably 30 or 60 days working on that one habit for you. And if that catches on like I think it might, we might just kind of instill a habit and then keep that one going, instill another habit, and just spend the rest of the year instilling 2 or 3, 6 good habits that will be lifelong for you. So we'll go beyond that morning routine, although we'll be adding it to your morning routine and going from there. So it's really, really some good coaching right here on Coffee with Dr. Scott. I think we're all going to like it. So I see Dennis and Chessa joining me. What was the best thing you had to eat this weekend? I need to know. After my fast, I'm curious about food. So share that with me down below. All right. I got everything in order now here. So like I said, I am out on tour. This week, as you know, I'm heading off to Phoenix and Las Vegas. Albuquerque didn't work out. So Phoenix and Vegas was so full. Excuse me. Heading out there this week. We're all done with that. We've got our playlist together. Got my food places all set up. Very excited for breakfast on Thursday at the Breakfast Club. It's actually my favorite breakfast place in the whole darn country. And then coming up next week, I'm off to New York City, Philadelphia, Baltimore. So I do need to know from you, and I think that was on that, what just came up there. I do need to know from you. There's a link in the comments down below. I need to know your favorite coffee shop in New York City. I'm going to be in Queens, Bronx area, but I'm also going over to Manhattan. So I want to do the show from a coffee shop in New York City. So let me know what the best coffee shops in all of New York City. I'm sure there are hundreds of them, if not thousands. But if you know a good coffee shop in New York City, let me know where they are so I can go live from my show from there. All righty. So we got all this stuff done. All right, let's dig into the first essence component. We all know what the first essence component is, right? It's cost. So let's talk about how cost affects referrals in your practice. Now, again, cost can affect a lot of things in your business, but this particular program is just about referrals. So let's just talk about referrals and referral blockages. And I put this topic up first for a reason. In the most of the practices I go into and I look at the referral scores, it's not uncommon that I find that just by cleaning up that cost component, referrals really begin to flow. So this is one of the best places to start. To narrow it down today, I really want to talk more about cost or referral blockages. So again, I look at referrals in two different ways all the time. Is cost blocking you from getting referrals and how we can typically use it to our advantage? So we'll get into that later in the week. But right now, let's look at referral blockages. And there's two ways cost can affect referral blockages. Two different categories, if you will. One is expense-based and one is income-based. So for the expense-based referral blockage, it's something a little different than what you're thinking of as far as what your cost to the consumer is. This is really what it's going to cost you. It's the cost for you to remove referral blockages. Excuse me, a little something in my throat this morning. I didn't notice it until I started talking. So an expense-based referral blockages, an expense-based referral blockage is something that you can correct, you, the doctor, by committing more money to your practice in the form of additional overhead. So this is done to provide patients with better service, with more service, with more staff. It could be more clinic space. It could be additional reception staff, even to hire another doctor. This is a type of blockage that's solved by spending money. It's usually pretty scary, right? We don't want to spend more money in the practice because there's always a possibility that there won't be any improvement after the money has been spent. But this has to be done strategically. And you've got to look at areas in your practice where you know you start thinking to yourself, you know what, I can see more patients. I know I can see more patients. Like, I have all this downtime, or my staff has all this downtime, or I have all this clinic space. So you know you have an area where you can see more patients, but there's one thing, and you got to find it. That's a referral blockage where you do have to spend money. But too often people are spending money on marketing, which won't do them any good because they have a referral blockage anyway, a capacity blockage, and they haven't found it. They're spending more money on more clinic space when they don't even have the staff to feed it anyway. They haven't filled the space they have yet. So again, you got to find that one blockage. I will tell you, most of the time it's you. Most of the time it's you, the doctor. Sometimes it's the staff, and sometimes it's definitely the number of rooms you work out of and or equipment, especially if you're doing kind of therapy or rehab, that kind of stuff. So you're moving the patient through, but there's not any place for them to go. They get stuck. Doctors that work out of one room and see patients at less than 8 or 10 minutes per clip, you probably need to go to two rooms. So there are things there where you want to spend money, so there is a cost involved, and that's referral blockage. So your patients aren't getting good enough service because of that capacity blockage, because of that referral blockage. So they're not going to refer to you because they know they have to wait. And if they have to wait, now, when I start talking about waiting, I get a little nervous because I know so many people put systems in place because they don't want their patients to wait. And I'm telling you, your patients should always wait. They just can't wait that long. If your patient sits in your waiting room for a minute to 5 minutes, that's perfect. They should have a little wait. They should just be like, oh, here's the doctor, because then they think you're too available, and that's not a good thing either. But if they have to wait 20 minutes, 30 minutes for every appointment, they're not going to refer people because they don't want to wait 25 minutes, 35 minutes. So cost in this thing is something that costs you money to fix, and you need to find it and fix it and spend that money so that you can have a better turnover time for your patients. And again, don't look at that as like an assembly line type practice. That's not what I mean. It's just a good turnover time that they get a good, efficient visit, and they want more people to come here. They want to create more energy. They want to share that information with you. So that's the first thing. Expense-based cost referral blockage is to spend the money you have to spend to increase your capacity and have good service for the patient so that they want to refer to you. The income-based blockage, however, involves knowingly giving up some of your income, giving up a certain amount of revenue in exchange for more patients and more revenue later. So an example there would be lowering your prices for your exam, lowering your prices for day one, or depressurizing or backing off in your case presentation. So during perfect case acceptance, we talked about being non-assertive or assertive and finding a balance in the middle. So it might be that you're pushing too hard to get the sale today, to get that big number, and maybe you have to back off that, accept less today to get more later. So an income-based cost referral blockage would be you selling too big of a case, so patients are A, either scared off and don't convert in the first place, or B, they convert, but with high pressure, and they don't want to put their friend in that situation. So they don't go out and refer people because they don't want their friend to feel the pressure that they just felt, or they have a tough time explaining why it's worth the money that they just spent. I actually was at Easter dinner just yesterday with, what is she to me? My wife's brother's wife's sister, whatever that is. It's my cousin or something like that. Anyways, and she was just started with a chiropractor. She's very skeptical, talking to me about it. She's a teacher. The chiropractor she goes to a bunch of, does some teacher appreciation massage weeks. And she's like, he's just got it. You know, he's got all of the teachers in our school there. And she was telling me about insurance. She's just going through all this stuff. And she's like, but it's $1,000 down payment, which I'm not against. Like $1,000 is not that much. But to her, as she was saying it, it's $1,000 down payment to even get started with him. Again, I'm not against that. Don't sit me wrong. I'm like $3,000-$4,000 up front with nothing else is where we start to worry about those things. But $1,000 is not too much. But you can hear the hesitation in her voice. Like, you're not going to start unless you can pay that $1,000. So you do have to be aware of those things. Maybe you have to do some surveys. Maybe you have to talk to some of your best patients and find out where that number is in your community, because it is different everywhere. It's going to be a lot different in Manhattan than it's going to be in rural Kansas. And you got to find out what your number is and make sure that people are comfortable with the money that they pay you. And if that means backing off a little bit on your cost up front in order to get the patient to A, convert, and B, refer, then do that, because it's going to lead to more patients later, which is more money later, simply by backing off a little bit up front. And then I also talked about potentially exam fees. Too many people have such a big upfront fee. They're like, well, if I'm going to do that exam, I should get all this money. And don't disagree with you. You have a great service. Now, I'm also not talking about lowering your fees with the $19 coupons, that kind of stuff. I'm talking about finding the place in the middle where you have expert status, but you're also not creating a high barrier of entry that people can't get through your door in the first place in order to get more service. Somebody that walks into your facility and didn't ask about exam and then gets hit with like a $300 or $400 bill on day one, it's unlikely they're going to come back for day two, because they think they have another $300 or $400 bill. It might not be that way. You might have had an exam for $300, then $50 the next day, but they never get there to find out because they're like writing that check, worried about it. So you've got to be conscious of these things. So I don't want you to, like I said, I don't want you to cheapen yourself with all the coupons and all that kind of stuff, but I do want you to find a good, reasonable first day for your community that is acceptable and gets people through the door and gets them started. And maybe you lose. Maybe instead of charging $300, you charge $75. And you lose $225 up front, but you convert better and you get more referrals. Well worth it. That's some of the best marketing money you can spend. So that's an income-based cost referral blockage, is how much you charge to get people in the door and how much you charge up front for people to start care. So those things you got to look at. So you perhaps look at depressurizing or backing off in your case presentation. So again, this income-based blockage is solved by taking a little bit less money from each patient up front to get more patients and more referrals later. Got that. So I see Matt joining me. What was the best thing you ate for breakfast for this week, Matt? I just came off my fast. I shared some of my things earlier, some great things I ate all weekend. I'm looking forward to eating more this week, but I do feel great. Anybody else? We're also talking about these challenges. Is anybody up for a fasting or a nutrition challenge? 2 weeks, a month. If you are, just raise your hand, put a comment down below, something like that. Make sure you hit that thumbs up button for me today. And again, there is a link down below about my a great coffee shop in New York City. Make sure you give me that as well, because I will be heading out there next Monday. So later in the week, I do want to do this show from a coffee shop in New York City. Let me know. I will talk to you all tomorrow morning, 7 a.m.